let's start this journey. Exciting journey. I'm equally, you know, excited. It's like this that I've started again my teaching career, which I did about 20 years ago. So why we call this as a boot camp? Because we will be requiring your commitment. We'll be requiring 3 months from your time, because we would be focusing deep dive on VAT, on starting a company and launching a company. So these three are the distinct phases. And as I said earlier, that whole objective for this boot camp is what? Our objective is to start, run, and grow your business, okay? Which will ultimately be the VAT consulting business. So how we'll do this? How we will achieve this? Of course, we need to have the expertise in depth, which would be a technical expertise. The difference between this boot camp and a normal training, which we deliver also, or which you have attended earlier, is that you are focused on generic VAT understanding, okay? Or primarily you're focused on your job itself. But here we are expecting you to be excellent in VAT consultancy side, which means your client can come from any industry. He can come from insurance, he can come from banking, he can come probably from a very small service company, a technology entity, hospitality sector, trading business, construction business. So all these have different areas for them. So our focus is, the first thing would be that we make you technically equipped enough so that you are able to answer the queries on the spot, or at least handle those clients. Second one is that we would be focusing on starting your own business in the form of a legal entity. Although you can do it as a sideline, or as Faizan has said earlier that he may be doing it for his company and in future he would be thinking about it. So which free zone, which emirate, what legal structure, which business activity, where to form your company, all these things would be the second phase. Final phase, as we already have a discussion, is that we would be starting to market the business. Now, accountants are born shy. When I say born shy, I was also from the same field and I was in the same shoes till I started the business about 12 years ago. And I thought that the first and foremost job of any business owner is to sell. If you cannot sell, you cannot start the business, because ultimately it's your baby. It's your responsibility to bring business in. So we would be focusing in our final phase also that how this overall business will grow, how we'll be getting the clients, and we'll be discussing this in detail also. So this bootcamp journey is divided into 4-5 phases. Okay. In our first phase, we would be focusing on VAT law itself. Okay, when I say VAT law, it means that we will be having laws and regulations. Now, VAT law was, let's say implemented about three years ago or 4 years ago in terms of VAT GCC VAT framework, but it has since been upgraded also. For example, the recent upgradation is that FTA has issued a revised VAT executive regulation, which is altogether a new document now with few changes, but still it is a new document. And along the journey for last 3 years, there are around 40 plus updates out there, which are in the form of clarifications, which are in the form of laws updates, which are in the form of the cabinet decisions, free zones, charity, construction, okay, expo business related, all these things. Okay, we'll try to cover in our first phase. Now, in our first phase, we have a sub phase, which is industry specific focus. Why this is important? Because I don't want you to be a generic, you can say, VAT consultant. I want that when a client comes from specific industry to you, you should be equipped enough to know their problems, to know their common VAT issues, and how to handle them. For example, a client from insurance would be altogether different from a client from hospitality sector. So all these have different VAT implications. So very soon we would be shifting towards VAT industry specific issues. And in this phase, we will be sharing with you the specific problems, case studies, how to, you know, have a conversation with, okay, with the authority itself. So all these things, okay, from the angle of a specific industry. For example, if you get a client from oil and gas, okay, now oil and gas have got altogether a different, you know, VAT application. Its applicability is under, you know, let's say RCM. At some stage it would be, you know, zero rated. At some stage it would be, you can say, taxable. So it's a tedious job to handle, you know, oil and gas. Or probably if you are having somebody from insurance side, then again it is you know, a technical area. So we would be having industry focus sessions where we have already highlighted 8 to 10 most common industries, and we'll be discussing their whole ideas. Next phase would be of the company formation. And I will explain you in detail also about this. Next would be the marketing side. And finally, we'll have the go live area, which we are expecting within 3 months of, okay, from here onwards. So I've already explained you that in the first phase, that law would be here. We have already a degree for number 8, which in short we'll be calling as DL number 8, which was a bare act, which was a law only. Okay. And this was explained in VAT executive regulations. Next, we have VAT guides. Next, we have VAT clarifications. Next, we have industry specific VAT consulting. So all these things would be in our phase one. Next, as I said, we'll be having the company formation, mainland versus the free zone. Bank account opening is also an area which is nowadays quite a big issue in different companies, because not every bank would be offering this service. Marketing and business development. After we have covered every area about the technical side, this is the most important thing, because here you will start getting your business. So we'll see how you will have your digital footprint. Now, digital footprint is important, because when you are a startup, why would somebody come to you? They will not be having any idea that there is a company XYZ started as fresh. So you have to prove yourself in the eyes of somebody by making an impressive presence online. Okay. So we'll see that your site making, social media, marketing on that, client hunting, and using a tool also, which you will be encompassing all these things. And the tool what we'll be using is called Zoho. Okay. So I'll share with you that how, without hiring anyone, any specialist for social media, you can easily do a management of your own company and look big in the, you know, in the eyes of your, you know, potential clients. And finally, we would be having a phase to launch the business, where we'll see that you will have the client onboarding during, you know, our sessions. This phase would come frequently, because I will share with you some templates, some, you know, checklists, some key points, which when you are taking a client onboarded, you have to give him, you know, a proposal. You have to have a VAT reconciliation for him. You have to have some formats as a checklist to safeguard yourself, so that, you know, you should not skip anything when you're dealing with any new client. So all these, you know, templates will also be shared with you guys. And your pricing structure, because ultimately this whole idea for this bootcamp is to get money, earn money offering your services. So how you can, you know, how you can basically price yourself, what factors you have to see that if somebody is coming to you and you are in you know, a cutthroat competition, how to structure your pricing. So this will have, you know, a discussion. And then finally, we'll also have in, you know, in this phase that client should stay with you. Okay. Retention of you, you know, of your ex-client, because it's okay, fine. I'll do my advertisement. I would have a, you know, a reference. I may be able to get my client first time onboarded with me. But the best juice from this business is that when we get the clients in, you know, in you can say frequency, where every 3 months I would be sending him an invoice without spending anything from my side. I would not do any advertisement. I'll not do anything else. But this client should stay with me. So every 3 months, I should be, you know, I should be invoicing him. And the best part of this business is that once you have your client, average age that client lives with you is between 2 to 3 years. Okay. Because when you are, you know, a set consultant with a client, it's very hard for him to change the tax consultant. Okay. Unless until there is a problem or there is a pricing issue or any such area. So we'll focus on how we can have a retention of our client. Okay, so all of you who have already been enrolled, you have got the access of our online portal. There is a link for this. You must have got your ID and the password. So once you do a login there, you will find VAT Bootcamp course. In this course, every time we'll do a, you know, a session, okay, within a day or two, this recording will be uploaded in sequence. Plus all slides, okay, handouts, notes, examples, case studies, everything would be uploaded here. So it is a resource available for you after that. In the same bootcamp area, we'll also upload the VAT laws, guides, updates, okay, as well as the clarification. So it would be a single, if you can say, a repository where you will be able to access it, and its access would be available to you for, you know, you can say, or 12 months itself. So you will have a, you know, a year of time with you where you can do a review of all this, watch them again and again, and so on and so forth. Plus, I've also given you access for UAE VAT trainings, which is a bundle program already there. It is already conducted. Okay, these are online trainings which are already available with you, and it comes free for all the bootcamp students. So you can view them. There are already, you know, recordings of around 3 to 4 hours. So for those of you who does not have a background in VAT or have not handled it frequently, you have to watch this. You have to watch all three trainings, because it will give you a basic understanding. Okay. I expect from you that you have the basic understanding, although we'll start from scratch. But as I said, our focus would be on handling the key areas. So I have already done a 3-4 hour session, and you will find here how to file a tax return. So all training is already there stepwise. How do we do the filing? You will have a basic VAT training there. You will have advanced VAT training also there. So please, for any one of you who does not have the background, or even if you have the, you know, have the background, please do, you know, have a look into it. And especially a training which is called as advanced VAT training. It is already available here in this course. So as I said that you already have this option, and please feel free to, you know, do a utilization of this resource also. It also contains all the basically session handouts also. So you can already get the material there. Now, if we just analyze that once we are over with this whole boot camp, okay, what sort of client assignment we expect? In VAT business, we will divide our assignments in two categories. Okay, one would be which are frequent, recurring nature, which would be, you know, coming each month, each 3 months, all these things. And second one would be the one-off things. Now, first we'll see that when you will start your own business of VAT consulting, Here are four areas where you will get frequent requirement from your existing clients or probably from new clients. First one and the foremost is filing of tax return. This is your bread and butter. From here, you will earn your maximum income every 3 months. Next would be VAT registration. VAT registration is basically for those clients who are starting new or who have started earlier but have not filed their VAT registration. VAT registration client can ultimately be your tax return filing client. So you will charge him for the tax registration also, as well as afterwards you can have him as your recurring client. Next, you will also get VAT health check reviews. Now, in this area, the client will say, I'm a company, I'm a decent sized company. I already have my tax team. I already have my CFO accountant with me, but I want a third party with a fresh pair of eyes, have a look on my all items. And you would be surprised to know that this is an area which can pay you the maximum. Because in this case, he may ask you, please review my 2 years tax record or for last 3 returns. So you can charge appropriately, plus you have a fair idea that you will go into this client, do a VAT internal audit area. Fourth one would be VAT ad hoc advice, where your client, you know, it could be your existing client or it could be a new client or it could be old client who was with you and now he says that, okay, fine, it's pretty much that I can handle it on my own. But suddenly he may have some issues. So your ad hoc advice area is situational, okay, where client can come say that, for example, I'm importing the items, the import agent will do its clearing, and he'll be charging me VAT. What should I do? Or I'm buying something from free zone, what should be the VAT treatment? So in these cases, these are your frequent VAT assignments, which we would be which would be a frequent earnings source also. One-off assignments are the areas which we feel which won't be very frequent, but here also you can earn a decent amount. So first one would be a deregistration, where client is closing down the business, where you feel that now somebody has come to you saying that I am my sale has gone very, very, thin sale, and please, I don't want to continue. So help me to do a deregistration, which is a tedious process, which requires a conversation with the authority, sharing with them the information, plus doing a VAT reconciliation, prior to this. So deregistration is a good assignment and it would not be that much frequent, but still it would be an offering for us. VAT reconsideration would be where FTA has imposed a fine on somebody and he's coming to you and he's saying, please appeal on my behalf. Now it is another excellent area because this client is a sure shot client, because he has to file appeal to FTA. Okay, again, a one-off assignment, but still it could be a good area for you to earn. Then we have FTA private clarification. Now, FTA private clarification is that where we approach FTA on behalf of our client and seek the clarification on a specific scenario. This is another area where you can do it for your existing clients or for some outside clients who just want to have this. So these 7-8, services would be our core income generating activities. Some would be, frequent, some may be just ad hoc basis. Now, during this whole session of 3 months, our focus would be that if a client comes for any of these services, how you as a future tax consultant will handle this. Now, these are the areas which we do not train in our generic VAT training, because in generic VAT training, we do not do this. And this is the area where we'll focus on. Rabia, please ask the question.
Yes, please, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Actually, normal VATI private clarification is invoiced separately. It's not within the VAT ad hoc advice.
I will answer you. It's a very good question. Now, it all depends your scoping exercise, which you have done initially when you are signing up the client. Now, filing VAT private clarification is a tedious job. So we have also learned this by experiment, by putting our hands in it, that we should, when we are signing the initial agreement with our client for filing the VAT return, we should categorically mention that any VAT private clarification will be charged separately. Because when you are engaged as a return filer, you do a repetitive job. You go to the client, you analyze his existing things, and probably file the VAT return. But filing a tax clarification will eat up your time, because you will prepare a very comprehensive case. You will refer the VAT law segments, articles which are applicable on this scenario. Then FCA will ask you, give us your opinion. Give us alternate opinion which you feel. Give us a reference from any other global VAT law. Okay? So all these things will eat up your time. Now, being a consultant, what we are selling? We are selling the time. So if you will just, you know, onboard your client without doing a proper scoping, client will say, okay, file this private clarification also with your filing of tax return. Now, it's not appropriate, because probably only with a single client, filing private clarification may eat up your 48 hours. Now, 48 hours means approximately a week's time at least. So if you will not do it in the scoping, then of course client will come. But it depends if you are already charging a significant fee to your client. For example, let's say you charge on average for a return filing only 3,000 dirhams. But you have engaged a client to whom you are charging already 8,000 each time. Now, if such client comes to you, he's already paying you 8,000, which means in a period of a year, he's already paying you 30,000 plus. So probably with such clients, I will decide, okay, I will give you a private clarification also in this. But if a client is a very small client, he is already only paying you 850 dirhams. Now in that, if he comes to you that please file a clarification, then it's not appropriate for as a consultant. So I would say that it all depends on your scoping. Better to keep it separate. Afterwards, you can give it to your client as a favor also. If he is a big client for you, okay, fine. I'll say, yes, I will do a filing for you for this clarification. I'll not be charging you anything. Yes, I hope, Rabia, that it is clear.
Yes, can I just ask one more question?
And yes, please.
Probably I'm wrong, since I don't have experience in that field.
No problem. Please tell me.
From my point of view, if I'm advising a big company, let's say, which can afford to pay any quotation that I submit, the idea is I will consider if in the return filing any advice is included, I will consider if I will charge them a private clarification with FDA. It means I'm charging them an advice that I am not sure personally without the FDA about the answer of this advice. This is why I'm going to the FDA, and this is why I'm charging them. It means because of the lack of my experience, I'm charging more my client. Is it the logic is right or no?
No, I will answer you this. It's not like this. See, let's assume when you undertook your client, he was doing, a business only in UAE, or he was doing X activity. You have agreed with him about a scope, about a price, okay, which is that I will only file your X return. I won't do your previous health check. I won't do something which is beyond the scope of his filing of your X return. Now, client is coming up with a new business activity. There is no harm in filing a clarification. And as I said, that if it is a big client, I will not charge him. It's my strategy. But if it is a small client, I should, in my scope document, would expressly mention this, that I would charge for filing a tax clarification where there is a confusion. Because at times, I will give you the practical idea. You are a consultant. You will tell your clients you cannot claim this input VAT, or you should charge VAT on this. Client can come back to you and he will say, no, I don't believe this. My friend is saying that I can claim this input VAT, or I should not charge VAT. Now, your job is to give the option. My opinion is this. I feel that we should not claim this input VAT, or we should charge VAT on that. But if you believe so, that you have a split opinion, it's better we can opt for a private clarification from FT. So it is always a situational area. And as I said, that it can also come to you for your old clients. It can also come to you for your existing clients and for somebody who is not your client. So you will see a scenario. Now, this, asking, from FTA is always a safe side. If your amount involved is higher, and even if your client is saying, I will not pay you anything, you being consultant, always play safe and file the clarification. Now, about the pricing, I would, just leave it on you as a consultant to make a decision. And it's very much situational. We as a consultant, sometimes we charge for this. Sometimes we do not charge for this. So it is an area. That's why I said it is, a one-off area. In case if you feel that the client will not pay me, or he will doubt my, abilities, so at least you can simply say, okay, fine, I'll not charge you anything. Let's at least file this clarification. I hope it is clear by now.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, fine. So these are the areas which we'll focus on this whole session, and everything from the tech point of view, keep in mind that something would be fitting in any of these things. Okay. Now, where we'll be focusing? Our focus here is that VAT law comprises of different sections, different clarifications, different, documents issued by FT. Those are, we divide them in two categories. Some are just academic, some are practical. For example, academics could be history of this VAT application. Some provisions which are just for the sake of it. For example, as and when you see when a tax law starts, it says that the cabinet has reviewed this section or a law. We are not concerned with that. As a tax consultant, we don't focus on that unless until very specific scenario arises there, or very rare circumstances. For example, when this VAT law was about to be implemented about 3-4 years ago, there was a clause which was based on transition. That if a contract started in 17 and you are completing in 2018, how it will impact the VAT application. So now at present, it's all history. It has been 3 years. Very rarely you will have at present such circumstances where the contract was started in 17 and client wish to have some information from you. Most likely it would be in, let's say, industries where the contracts are over 3-4 years, for example, the construction industry or any such area. So on academic side, yes, you should study, but don't worry about this, because if ever a client comes to you, you always have the option to refer these areas. Okay, practical areas are where we would be focusing on much more, which are used on daily basis. Now, understand one thing. I don't expect you at the end of the session to basically memorize the VAT law. It's not the case. Me doing it day in, day out for last 4 years, I don't memorize the section number. I don't memorize the you know, section area. What I should know as a consultant is that if client comes to me and he says that, for example, place of supply query, I should know where to go and find it in the tax law, executive regulation, GCC VAT framework, or VAT clarification. Because we are acting as a consultant. We always consult, okay, tax provisions before forming any opinion. So once you are through with this, what I would expect you to have the understanding, but before advising the client, we always do a reference to a VAT law, because it is so complex, you have to, you know, read it again and again. So we would focus on all those, you can say, the practical areas. Okay, sir, up till here, if in case anybody wish to ask me anything, please feel free to ask. Otherwise, we'll start our, okay, practical areas. All okay? Okay, good. All clear. All clear. Let's go ahead. Okay, now what we'll do is that we will now start with the overall legal framework. This is the first area where you should know that from where you will get the VAT knowledge. We'll go through almost all of these in this session. So I just want to show you the umbrella here. On top, it sits GCC VAT framework. So you can just, you know, imagine it as an umbrella. Below this, all VAT laws, regulations are being formulated. Now, each country, for example, Saudi has got its own VAT laws, Bahrain has its own VAT laws, we in UAE has our own VAT laws. They seek a guidance from VAT framework. Okay, VAT framework is just a framework. It is, you have to focus on VAT laws of every country which are issued. But it is a very small document, so I would urge you that you can simply, you know, go through this. But when it comes with the applicability, we focus on tax laws, but we can infer from this. For example, here we will infer from this framework. If I am going to, you know, to FTA to file a private clarification, and I have to create a, you know, a reference of some article, which I do not find from tax laws here, I can always go and search in VAT framework. If, you know, if I find, you know, a reference, I can do it in my VAT, you can say, private clarification. Below this, the first thing would be VAT law, which is in short degree law number 8. It is a thin document which FTA issued just to give you an idea about that what would be the bare, you know, provisions of this tax law which they are implementing, and it came around in 2017, probably in August. Next came VAT executive regulation, where they have practically explained each and every area. Normally, when your client comes to you or when you start your own venture, you will be most likely focusing on this document itself because it has so much, you know, clarity for you. And tax procedures, where the authority FTA about those procedures. So for example, if few of you ultimately would be opting for becoming a, you know, approved tax agent, your agency, you know, obligations, okay, rights, VAT record keeping, all these things, VAT audit, everything is covered here in tax procedure, which in short we'll say as TPL. And this executive regulation would be ER. These terms we'll be using frequently. Okay, DL8 for this VAT law, ER for executive regulation, and TPL for tax procedure law. And in the same fashion, it has the executive regulation itself. Next, we have some of the public clarifications. As I said, we can have the option to file a private clarification. In the same fashion, we are having already option to see the public clarification. When so many people ask the same query from FTA again and again, they come up with some open clarification which are available to each one. So these are very, very handy, and especially for tax consultants, because these are the areas where either, you know, in text procedures or in DL or in ER, it would be silent or it would be a gray area, but FDA has come out with a text clarification. Now, just to give you a point, text, these public clarification cannot supersede the text law. And FDA says at the end that these are issued as a guidance only. So it's up to you how you fit them in a scenario, but you have to, the ultimate responsibility would be on you. So we seek just the guidance from these public clarification. And finally, as I said, that we can also file the, you know, the private clarification here also, which will be only available to us. And normally we file it to FDA. FDA has got 60 days. There is a, you know, separate form, which we'll be discussing afterwards, where we have to, you know, create a complete case to FDA. And okay, within 60 days, we get a reply. Okay, it would be from FDA on their own, you know, stamp and everything, so that we have something in hand, but it is only available to us. Okay, sir. Moving on from here, as we have this whole idea now, so let's review VAT laws. Now, this is the first area for you. What we'll do here is that we will first see the key terms defined in VAT law. It is very, very important, being a tax consultant, that when you will be, you know, you'll be getting a query or you will be reading the text contents, there would be a simple word. For example, it is applicable if place of supply is in UAE. Now, what is place of supply? FDA will not define everywhere. It is already defined in the preamble section, first section of VAT law. Or it can say, if your fixed establishment is in this emirate. Now, what is fixed establishment? Or if you import the goods, if you export the goods, if you are a tax agent, all these things are defined at you know, a single place. So as today we are having our intro session. So the first thing what we will see is definitions, okay, which is the most important area to understand the whole concept of a tax applicability. So I will share with you my screen. And please do let me know once you are able to see this. Let me come to the section of text law. Are you able to see my screen? Okay, fine. I believe all of you can see. Great, Jawar. Okay, Paul. So basically, what I have here with me is degree or number 8. Okay. And this was issued, as I said, in 17. This defines the key terms. This is a bare VAT, you know, regulation. As I said, we will not be concerned with which laws have been taken care here. It's fine. It is, you know, academic thing. So our first area here is definitions. Now I'll go through each and every one. Okay, some would be, you can say, pretty obvious. Some would require a debate on them. So, but you should know as a consultant that as and when something comes in VAT articles, different segments of a tax law and term being used, you should always come here and see the definition so that you have an idea that, okay, what exactly would be the context in that article. So wherever I have the word state, it always means UAE. It goes without saying, but just to have an idea, authority is FDA, ministry is Ministry of Finance. VAT is a tax which is imposed on import and supply of goods. Okay. Including the deemed supply. Now, these all terms would be defined here, but we have an idea here that a tax which we call as VAT is also imposed on imports, is also imposed on supplies, and it's also imposed on deemed supply. Deemed supply, I will explain you afterwards, which just means assumed to be supplied, okay, for example, free goods. Tax if anywhere we use the word tax, it would always mean VAT here, because in, you know, in UAE we also have excise tax. So that is altogether a separate. Throughout this VAT law, if we use the word tax, it would always be VAT. GCC states, full member, okay, and at present we have 7 states. We know that they are having their own GCC charter. So GCC states simply mean all the states which are included in GCC framework. But there is a difference when we say implementing states. In so many sections of this tax law, you will see that the word is being used implementing states. For example, when we trade between implementing states, when we import from implementing state, these are the states which are currently, okay, which have implemented the tax and which fulfill the requirement of being an implementing state. Now, why this is important? First thing you should know that at present, we do not have any concept of implementing state applicable, although we have a definition. The reason is that implementing states require that all the GCC member state, I will answer you, Jawad. At present, there are only 3 countries which have implemented the VAT. So we have KSA, we have UAE, and we have Bahrain with us. These 3 are the ones. But they do not qualify of being implementing state. The reason for that is what? Reason is that implementing state requires to have a central electronic VAT system, which is interconnected. At present, we do not have this. So in KSA tax law, it is mentioned that unless until there is a central electronic VAT system with all GCC states, we do not consider anybody as implementing state. Bahrain also just copy-pasted the Saudi VAT law. The UAE VAT law said that we will only consider somebody as implementing state if the other state will consider us as implementing state. Saudi will not consider them at present. Bahrain will not consider them at present. So UAE also will not consider them at present, implementing state. So what it means is that at present, whether you import from Saudi or you export to Saudi or you deal with Bahrain or you deal with any other future countries which will implement the VAT, it is same as we are dealing with India, China, America, anywhere, because we do not have the concept of implementing states applicable at present. Now, okay, Faizan has asked me that in case this, Qatar, no, at present Qatar has not implemented, Oman has not implemented, and Kuwait has not implemented. So these 3 also has not yet implemented. Okay, they do not have the VAT law implemented. But even if they will implement the VAT law, Jawad Faizan, there would be requirement of centrally connected VAT system. Without that, implementing state will not be applicable. Next concept which we'll see is goods. Very frequently we'll see that if you supply the goods, if you import the goods, goods are zero rated, goods are this standard rated. So this word goods mean what? Any physical property, okay, any physical property which can be supplied to anyone, this is goods. Now make sure we understand the word as a consultant. It is not only a thing which can be transferred to anyone physically. It's not a movable thing only, but it is a physical property which we can touch and see. It also include the real estate. It also include water, all forms of energy. So these 3 areas, physical goods, real estate, and energy forms, water and electricity, these are also considered as goods. This plays a very important emphasis on when we are considering real estate, and when in our future sessions we will see that how we establish place of supply of some properties. So this will follow a rule which will which we would be considering for place of supply for the goods, because real estate, water, forms of energy are basically considered as the goods. Now this will also play a role where we'll be considering the concept of zones, designated zones. So if you have a property in a designated zone or outside a designated zone, treatment will be different because property is being treated as goods. Next one is services. Very simple. Anything which won't fall in goods would be services. Okay. So by law, we have definition of only for goods. We do not have definition of services, and we simply say that anything which do not fall for the goods would be services. So it means even if I'm establishing that whether something is service or it does not fall in service, I have to go back and first establish that it is, whether it is falling in this area for goods or it will not be. So, and we have a detailed discussion also on this. Next one is import. This would be applicable mostly when you are doing trading businesses. So you will have import. Now VAT law, when we'll have articles, it won't specify that what is import, because import is decided here. It is arrival of goods from abroad. So unless until we do not receive goods here, it won't be import. For example, just imagine that you have been faced with a scenario. Somebody is asking you that you are my tax consultant or I need advice. When I give advance payment to my supplier outside the country, is it my import? Should I declare it at that time? So you won't find answer anywhere but here, which says it is arrival of goods. Unless until you don't get the goods, it's not import for you. Or receipt of services. So unless until you don't receive the services, it's not import. This clause will help you a lot when you are doing the reverse charge mechanism, RCM things. For those of you who don't have idea about RCM, when we import something, we use a mechanism called RCM. We'll be discussing afterwards also, who record the import VAT. So RCM will only be applicable if something fulfills this definition of import. So definitions would play a very important role in all these areas. Next is concerned goods. Concerned goods are the goods which are imported and would not be exempt if supplied in the state, because RCM is only applicable if you are importing the goods which are basically the concerned goods. Because if the goods which you are importing would be exempt in this country, if they are supplied locally, just imagine that it is a pencil. Now imagine that this pencil, if I buy from UAE, it is an exempt supply. So if I import the same pencil from outside in this country, this is an exempt also at the time of import. So it won't be considered as my import. So it's very important to understand that import VAT is only applicable for the concerned goods as well as concerned services. Okay. Now we have to see a person again, important area. It clarifies something. For example, a client comes to you and he says that I'm individual, I don't have any company and I'm doing, freelancing. I'm a photographer. So should I be, should I be getting a tax registration or not? Now, if someone will not be, aware of this concept, that whether you are a national person or a legal person, which means you are individual or you are a company, in both cases, you may have a responsibility to get VAT registration. So even if you are an individual, you may cross certain thresholds, which we'll discuss afterwards, and you will be required to file a tax return. So your clients can be individuals, your clients can be the companies, your clients can be the joint ventures, where two companies join together. Do not form a legal entity, but only form a joint venture. Your clients can be, it could be a partnership. It may not be just probably and you know LLC, but it could be informally a partnership. So individuals may also be required to get a, you know, a tax registration. So it comes down to a taxable person, which means any person, which means again, you know, individual or company, okay, which will be exceeding a threshold which has to get a tax registration. A taxpayer, anybody who is obligated to pay tax. Now, you'll be surprised to see that I have a taxable person and a taxpayer. Why these two things are, you know, are different? A taxable person is somebody who should get a, you know, who should apply to get a registration for tax, who should get a TRN for himself. But a taxable person is somebody who will require to pay tax. For example, end consumer. Of course, all of us at home are end consumer and we pay the tax here. But there could be certain scenarios where FTA said that supplier will not charge you the VAT, but you would be considered as a taxpayer. So you will pay on your own. So it is applicable in, you know, oil and gas industry. It is applicable in jewelry business. It is applicable at importation also. So that's why you could be a taxpayer only, or you could be a taxable person and taxpayer also. Next, we have the tax, you know, registration. It goes without saying that we'll file a, you know, tax registration and there's, you know, separate procedure for it, which we'll be discussing hopefully by today also. TRN is something which we'll get a, you know, a tax number after getting the approval from FTA. Now, okay, without TRN, we should not charge VAT to anyone because it is a requirement to be on the invoice. Second importance for TRN is that each taxpayer or taxable person most likely would have single TRN, one TRN only, unless until it basically becomes a part of a tax group. So if you are a tax group and you have three companies, A, B, and C, all three will share single TRN. So in all your invoices, okay, either issued from A, B, or C, you will have the same TRN. So TRN plays a pivotal importance in case if you are a tax, you know, if you are a tax group, that all 3, 4, 5, 8 companies would be using the same TRN. Tax registrant, of course, who has the TRN with him, okay, goods recipient who has been supplied or imported, pretty simple. So I'll just move on with very simple things. Importer. Now, term of importer is important because importer is the one whose name is listed as importer of goods on the date of import for custom clearance. Why this is important? For example, you are you have a client who says that I have ordered the guy locally. Okay, I'm a company A, I have ordered a company B. Your client is A, okay? He ordered company B, which is a local company. This B, okay, eventually ordered to his supplier, company C in China, and his supplier straight away ships to company A. Now, in this case, importer is company A. It's not company B. Okay, because importer on record is company A, and importer on record is the one normally who would be subject to import VAT. So make sure, at times we may feel, you know, confused, but we will come back to this definition and see who is importer. Importer is somebody who will be receiving the goods or who will be clearing the goods from the customs or who will ultimately be receiving the services. Taxable trader, again, anybody whose main activity is distribution of water and all types of energy. This is a specific clause which is applicable only in water and, you know, in energy area, as and when we'll be discussing all those sections. So we'll come back to this. Tax return, our main business where we will be filing for the client, it is always submitted on behalf of a taxable person itself. So we'll have a very detailed, you know, segment which will cover the tax returns, okay, from different industry client point of view. Okay, consideration, again, an important area, is that what we receive from the client. Okay, anything which is received or expected to be received. So we'll be using different words. Now, make sure that here in this definition, FT has not used the word cash. They have used the word all that is received. It means it may include cash. It may include anything else. So as we all know that there could be an exchange of goods. There could be a barter trade between us and you know, our client. I may supplying him training. He may supply me the, let's say, furniture to settle off that pricing. So, okay, you always have to be vigilant that for a client, when he is giving free to somebody anything, is he getting something in return of that? Your client may simply say, I'm just giving it free and I don't get it anything against it, but he may get something in return. For example, a pharmaceutical company gives a grant to a hospital, and that pharmaceutical company say, I've just given him the money and I haven't received anything. But hospital is saying that, okay, if you give us grant, in our entrance of the hospital, we will place a signboard of your company. Now, this is exchange of services, that you are paying to get advertisement services. So it falls under this consideration area, that all that is received, it's not only cash. Now, you won't find these things in VAT law when we'll be seeing the implementation. All this is only available in definition. Okay, in all the articles, VAT law will use the word consideration. And some people will only think that it is only cash, but it's not only cash, it is everything in between. Business. Business is any activity conducted on an ongoing basis. This word is very important, which means it won't be including your hobbies. Okay, it won't be including any one-off activities. Okay, what about samples and you know, FOC goods? Yes, sample and you know, FOC, if you are giving them as part of any taxable supply. For example, if you buy three goods, I will give you one item free. It won't be a taxable thing, because it is part of that consideration which you are getting for those goods. And for samples and gifts, we have a detailed segment, because it has certain threshold. If it is below 500, it would not be taxable, exceeding 500, and so on and so forth. So we have separate segments for taxation also, or the samples also. So business should be ongoing and independently carried out by any person. And it covers a lot of area, but you can simply think about this. If I'm doing something as a hobby, if I'm doing as a one-off business, for example, there is a charity, you know, charity, when say event, and I'm having a bakery, which, let's say I'm just a baker, and I go there, I put a stall there, I bake some cookies, I sell them, okay, and I give my money to that, you can say, charity. Now, I don't do this as a formal business. I just did as a one-off activity, or as, you know, or as just a hobby. So it won't be qualified as, you know, as a business here. So business is the first and foremost area to make a taxability to anyone. Exempt supply. a supply which is for consideration in furtherance of your business, okay, and tax authorities have declared it as exempt, and you cannot claim input VAT with regards to that supply. So we have a section for exempt supply, as here we are only discussing the definition. There are five items which are considered as exempt. One of the items is transportation business, these taxis and all those, you know, trams and such, you know, transportation, okay, local transportation. Now this is exempt. They cannot charge us tax, and they cannot claim their input VAT also because it is an exempt supply. A taxable supply, it does not include the exempt supply. Technically, this will include zero rated supply and the standard rated supply. We have a full section, so you don't worry in case some areas you don't understand, because these are the definition. I want you to have a habit that as and when you see a terminology in text, you know, articles which you do not understand, you have to come back to this place and see these things. Deemed supply, a supply which is assumed to be supplied. For example, you may not feel that it is a supply, but it is considered as a supply, so it will become a deemed supply. For example, where you give absolutely free any items, absolutely free, okay, you don't do anything, but you are still giving it free, and in some cases it would be considered as a deemed supply. We had a full-fledged section on that, but the definition comes from here. Input tax, simply a tax when you buy something or when you are conducting an import. Such tax paid by you would be considered as input VAT. Okay. Output tax is a tax which you charge on taxable supply, and any supply considered as a taxable supply. Here there is another, you know, another confusion. For example, I am a business and I am having a chemical factory. Now, out of the chemical factory, I may have some waste out of it, and there could be some waste which I can sell also. So I won't consider it as my sale, but I will simply record it as my other income. Now, throughout this VAT law, we do not use the word income, sales. We only use the word supply. That's it. Anything going out from a business would be a supply. So in this case, waste would also be a supply. So output tax has to be charged on that. Recoverable tax is the amount that we paid and may be returned by the authority. Now here I have first input tax. Next I have recoverable tax. What is the difference between these two? Let's assume I have two businesses. I have health insurance business and I have a, you know, life insurance business. Now in health insurance or life insurance, I am doing it in the same building. So my landlord, he charges me a tax, you know, a rent of 100,000, and I pay him 5,000 as a tax, which is my input tax in this scenario. This 5 is my input tax, but I know that life insurance is an exempt activity. So I cannot claim the input VAT which is incurred on exempt activity. For simplicity's sake, let's split these two. So I will say 2.5 and 2.5. So this 2.5, which belongs to my health insurance, is my recoverable tax, because I can claim it back from authority as input tax. This 2.5, which is for my life insurance, which is exempt category, I cannot claim it back. So 5,000 as a whole was my input VAT, out of which, okay, the recoverable is only 2.5, which I will show in my tax return. So difference between these two is very important. tax due is okay, simply after adjusting your recoverable tax from your output VAT, the balance amount which you have to pay will become your tax due. And payable tax is tax which is ultimately paid by you to the authority. Tax period, very important again, because we will file our tax return for a tax period. Normally it would be a quarterly one, but you will get some clients which are monthly. So I would say if you get some clients which are of having a monthly cycle, excellent clients, you try to get them even at a lower price also, because you will get each month billing cycle, as opposed to somebody who is having a quarterly period. A tax invoice which has been issued as per the requirements of FTA, which we'll be discussing afterwards. Okay, then the word is tax credit note, which is any time we incur any amendment to our taxable supply. For example, change of price, change of quantity, any such thing. So we issue a credit note, and we'll see its format also afterwards. Government entities, all ministries, local, federal, are all government entities. Normally, the entities which are commercially doing business and owned by the government are not straight away the government entities, but they fall under this same umbrella. Some will get registration, some will not get registration. For example, if you are living in Dubai, Diva is a government entity, but it has a TRF. So it charges you 5% VAT on electricity supply. But when you deal with Ministry of Finance, they do not charge you VAT, and they do not have a TRN also. So government entities will be dealt separately, and it is as per the government's own discretion. Charities, there is a list of charities already issued by the FTA available on their website, which will be having a specific VAT treatment, which we'll be discussing when we are having the charity section. Mandatory threshold, where if you cross that threshold, you have to apply for tax registration. So you have to keep in mind, at present it is 375,000 AED. This figure, if I cross in my taxable supply value in last 12 months, I will apply for my tax registration. Voluntary threshold is 187,500. This is a threshold. If I am between 187.5 and 375, I have the option to get a tax registration. Now, during the whole tax law, they will be referring the word mandatory threshold and voluntary threshold. But you know that mandatory means 375 and voluntary means 187,500. Transport related services, these are certain services, okay, which are specifically attract different treatment of VAT law, which we'll see afterwards. But whenever the tax law used the word transportation related services, shipping, packaging, cargo, custom documentation, container handling, loading, unloading, storing, moving of goods, all these things are in this ambit. So at that place, FTA will not explain it again. It is only explained here in transportation related services. Place of establishment, very important definition. Here are three definitions: place of establishment, fixed establishment, and place of residence. These are applicable when you are establishing a tax status of a company or establishing place of supply for a company. So place of establishment is pretty simple, even if we do not go with this definition, where we are incorporated legally. So legal establishment in any country is my place of establishment. Fixed establishment is any fixed place of business. Now here it's not saying that you have been legally incorporated, but it is saying any fixed place of business other than place of establishment in which person conducts his business regularly, permanently, and where sufficient human and technology resources exist. For example, your branch. I may have a company in Abu Dhabi and its branch in Dubai, but all my senior staff management sits in Dubai. So my fixed establishment is Dubai. My place of establishment is Abu Dhabi. Or it could be the case otherwise, I have incorporated a company in, you know, Italy and its branch is in Dubai. So its fixed establishment is in Dubai, but its place of establishment is in, if you can say, Italy. These destinations are important when we are establishing the place of supply. Very, very important. And we have to come back to these again and again. Believe me, we are doing tax for last 4 years in and out. But every time when I see a provision, I have to come back here because it's place of establishment, fixed establishment, and place of residence, all very, very confusing. But fixed establishment, legal incorporation. Place of establishment, legal incorporation. Fixed establishment, place of operation. And place of residence is the place where person has a place of establishment or fixed establishment in accordance with the provision of degree law. There would be certain scenarios where they will say that you should have place of residence in UAE. So in this case, whether I have my place of establishment in the in UAE or my fixed establishment in UAE, these combined are called as place of residence. For example, when we establish the place of supply for services. So it says it is the place of supply of services is where supplier has a place of residence, which means either he is incorporated here or he has a fixed establishment here itself. Okay, sir. Up till here, are you guys able to understand? Is it making some sense? Anything you guys wish to ask, please feel free to ask me here. Is it going okay?
Yes.
Fine, great. Okay. Moving on with these definitions, non-resident. Any person who does not own a place of establishment or fixed establishment in the state and usually does not reside in the state. Now, here you will see this law itself, this definition itself has used three definitions. First one, place of establishment. Second one, fixed establishment. Third one, state. All these have been defined. So somebody who does not have any place of operation in this country or legally incorporated in this country. So these things are being referred interconnectedly. Now, if you were only be seeing it first time that what is a non-resident, and you don't know place of establishment or fixed establishment, so you will come back here again and you will see, okay, what is place of establishment? What is the fixed establishment? And these things will happen again and again with you, again and again with you. So make sure you get yourself familiar with these definitions. These are very important areas. Okay. Next comes related parties, which are having under the common economic, financial, or legal control, which is most likely the group companies. If I am having three group companies, A, B, and C, owned by same owner, most likely it would be a related party status. This definition will be applicable when we are discussing the tax grouping. And again, tax grouping is also an area here you can charge your client. For example, you were having only company A as your client. He's coming that I have three more companies and I want to form them as a tax group. So you will follow a set procedure given by FDA and you can charge your client again for tax grouping. Custom legislation, mostly applicable on imports or dealing between zones and the mainland. So this we do not cover here, but anytime when this word would be refer, it means that the legislation which are applicable on the import or dealing between the zones. Designated zone, an area which is being designated by the cabinet here, by the FTA here. There are around 20 plus zones, including JAFSA, Hamriya, SAF zone, and so on and so forth, which has a specific tax treatment. Now, make sure you understand, with these zones, we do not mean free zones. It can be a free zone, but it may not be a free zone. So once we are discussing the zones areas, we'll at that time see that which are the designated zone and how these are being treated, and how if you are having a client from designated zone, how his tax return has to be filed. Normally, these clients are a bit, complex clients, because their each transaction can be different, because whether they are supplying within the zone, okay, or outside the zone, or exporting or importing, each one of these transactions have a different VAT application. Exports, departure of goods from state, or selling your services outside the state, okay, to a person whose place of establishment or fixed establishment is outside the state. Again, the same words are being used. Either he is legally incorporated here, or his place of operation is outside the country, so it would be export. Exports are always zero rated, okay. Next concept, a term voucher, which is just a promise by giving you an instrument saying that I am giving it to you, okay, you can encash it in future. Why this definition is important? Because sale of a voucher will not be a supply, will not charge VAT on that. So take an example, Dubai Mall is giving you a voucher of 500 dirhams and ask you to pay 500 and take this voucher. Next, you can go to any shop and shop on this voucher. So when you just get the voucher, it won't be a taxable supply. Okay. And in some cases, it will be a taxable supply, which we'll discuss afterward. But you should know that a voucher attracts a different supply, the VAT implication, and voucher does not include the postage stamps issued by EPG Emirates Post Group, because in the stamps also we give 5 dirhams and we get the stamp of equivalent value, but it's not considered as a voucher, so just specified here. So for example, if you're getting a client which is frequently issuing the discount coupons or such instrument. So you should know that merely when he sells a voucher of same amount, somebody gives him 100 and he will be getting back 100 and he'll be issuing the instrument of 100, it should not be a supply and it should not be shown in his tax filing also. Next one is activities which are conducted under sovereign capacity. Normally, you will not encounter this, but these are all activities which are the government activities and where there is no competition. Okay, so for example, in this scenario, you will have, let's say you apply visa of your employees and you go to Ministry of Finance, they will be charging you some fee, for example, 3,000 dirhams. This service of issuing visa is being given in sovereign capacity. Okay, they do not have any competition. They are the only authority which would be giving such services. So such activity would be the activities which are conducted under sovereign capacity. Why this thing is being defined here? Because when we see the article of whether the entities which are owned by the government should be applying for the X registration or they should not apply. So this is a prime factor. If they are conducting this activity under a sovereign capacity without any competition, they do not apply for the X registration. But if there is a competitor which is giving these services and it's not the sole authority which gives such services, so they would be getting this X registration. But these are certain areas which you as a tax consultant may not face very frequently. Next is capital assets. These are the assets which are used for a long-term purpose. For example, furniture, fixture, vehicles, all these things. Why these are basically treated separately? At two stages, capital asset definition will play a role. First, when we will be applying for a tax, for a TRN, for a tax, you can say, getting a status of a tax filer. So in tax registration application, we exclude the capital asset sales. For example, if I'm selling my goods, let's say I'm selling this pencil and my sale is 100,000 only. And in the same period, I have also sold my furniture or my fixed asset. In that case, that sale amount will not be considered here to calculate my tax threshold. Second scenario is when I'm, okay, as and when we'll be discussing the capital asset scheme. In that case, such assets which fall under the capital asset category would attract a different VAT treatment, and it is just immediate definition also. So capital asset scheme is a scheme where we claim input VAT upfront on buying furniture, fixture, building, any such thing, but keep a track on their, you know, on their consumption. Okay, that whether it is being used for a taxable supply or it is being used for an exempt supply. So it is again a complex area which we'll see. Okay, in between, it is applicable on your clients which would be having exempt supplies as well as a taxable supply. So in that case, we will focus on these two definitions. Next are the penalties, which are simply fines issued by authorities. Penalty assessment, an FTA issues a decision saying that you are subject to these fines. Excise tax, which we know that a tax which is imposed by FTA, but it is on alcohol, it is on sugary drinks and stuff like that, which we do not cover here, but it is altogether a separate tax law. Tax group, when two or more persons join hand together and form a single company itself. So this is pretty much all our definitions which we'll be using throughout the VAT law. So please make sure that as and when you are handling a client, or as and when you are studying on your own, anytime if you have any confusion that whether it is sixth place of establishment, whether it qualifies as import, you always come back to these definitions and go through this. Specifically, read them again and again, because when you are, just reading them, it may sound simple, but as and when we'll study the VAT law in detail, you will see that we'll start coming back to all these laws again and again. Okay, sir. So this ends up our first area here. Now, anything you guys want to ask, please feel free to ask me.
Sir, this could you please highlight the difference between, again, this place of residence and place of establishment?
Sure.
Would that place of residence would be applicable to a natural person or legal entity?
It's in both cases. I will explain you. Okay. For example, I'm somebody who has incorporated a company in, let's say, Bahrain. Okay.
Yeah.
This is where I have legally incorporated.
Yeah,
so
sure.
It becomes my place of, this establishment. Okay.
Yeah, establishment.
Next is I am having a branch in UAE. Here, all my management sits here. This becomes my fixed establishment. Okay. And as a whole, these two places would called as place of residence.
Okay.
Because you see here, place of residence is the place where a person has a place of establishment or fixed establishment.
So in both, in this case, the office in Bahrain standalone would be called as place of residence, or fixed establishment will be called as a place of residence.
Very good.
Interchangeably.
Here we see that which space, which place is closely connected with the supply.
Okay.
For example, I'll just give you an idea here. You are a guy who has office in UAE, in Dubai.
Okay. Sure.
You are dealing with the company whose head office is in Bahrain, but whose branch is in UAE. And you are supplying this service to head office only.
Okay.
And you are confused that its branch is in UAE. Should I charge him VAT or not? So here we'll see for this supply, which place is closely connected. So we'll see that the close connection is with its head office, which is place of establishment. So we'll treat it as an export. So these things, these three things are important to understand, and combined, these place of establishment or fixed establishment is called as place of residence. Is it clear?
Okay. Sure.
Okay.